It's 12:57. Let's start 3 minutes early. What do you say?
I think it's a brilliant idea because this maybe we'll get three more minutes out of you.
This is, I don't want to say it's a long lecture. It's only probably about 2.5 hours.
That's okay. Where are we going?
I mean, this subject is fascinating, and I've tried to find some Jewish connections in it too, and I think I did to a certain extent.
And quite timely.
Some people might get. So if they miss out on the first 3 minutes.
That's right. Hey, that's why you have to be always on time, early, right?
What I want to do is play you a couple things just to get you in the mood, okay? So the first piece I want to do, and I'm going to share the screen right now. The first piece I want to do is this one there. Everybody see George Gershwin and his melodies, right?
Yeah.
1 p.m. start, but we're starting early. What are you going to do? Here is we're talking about Gershwin. And so Ella Fitzgerald, Summertime.
First lady of song, is that her nickname? Maybe so.
Wow.
Maybe so.
Summertime. Fish are jumping, and the cotton is high.
They bought us $65.
Right?
Wow. They bought me that unit. They bought us $65.
I have a meeting with the DeFi philanthropy.
They have to mute us.
The philanthropy from
FIU. Baby, do.
And that's one of them. And I want to give you one other example before we start our lecture. This is a Japanese Hiromi Uehara, incredible technique. She's one of the best known jazz pianists in the world right now. And so, oh my God, I've seen some people here. Hey Mia, oh my God. So this girl is Hiromi Urahara, wonderful jazz pianist. Let's see what she does with I Got Rhythm, and then we'll start our lecture.
Thank you.
Wow, that was impressive.
It certainly was. So, you know, why don't we do this? Why don't we close our microphones now, and let's just see what happens. So sometimes when the music goes on, when you're commenting on it, it erases the music. So very aware of that. So let me start by saying this is an unbelievable subject, and it comes right out of what we were talking about last week, which is Yiddish American theater. So Gershwin calls himself a man without traditions. A lot of early 20th century composers would think of themselves that way. Aaron Copland goes to jazz rhythms, for example. Gershwin's approach was viewed, I would say, cynically. Concert works were labeled as, you know, tainted products of an outside, uneducated outsider. There is a musicologist, and I will read, writes, there was simply no pre-existing model for the kind of American composer that Gershwin became. He had to invent himself each step of the way, and it stands to reason that his remarkable success in doing so was met with skepticism and resentment by those personally invested in more traditional musical paths. Gershwin was of Russian and Lithuanian Jewish ancestry. His grandfather was in the Imperial Russian Army for about 25 years to allow himself to be a Jew who had the right to free travel and residence. He then moves to St. Petersburg, and the way I read about his life and the family, they were probably had close connections with the Bund movement, meaning the Bundist. It was a Jewish group that was a secular group, that was a socialist group, was the anti-communist group. They had a tremendous amount of culture in their milieu. There are a tremendous amount of working songs, Bundist working songs, and we still have recordings of them. I can certainly talk for a lecture on that. That's an incredible subject. So anyway, so he moves to Russia, falls in love with this girl by the name of Rosa Bruskina, who is the daughter of a furrier in Vilna. And they get married. They move to New York pretty soon after that because of the prevailing anti-Jewish sentiment in Russia. She changes her name instead of Rosa to Rose. And Moshe, who is her husband, that is Gershwin's father, changes his name to Morris. What else? Now their name is Gershowitz, okay? And they change their name to Gershwine. G-E-R-S-H-W-I-N-E, not Gershwin, but Gershwine. So their first child, and this is an incredibly important figure in the history of theater music, and he's not a composer, and his name is Ira Gershwin. He's born in 1896, then they move, right after that, they move to a second floor apartment. And I'm going to now do the sharing the screens, if you don't mind. And we will look at what we have here. Okay, here we go, one sec. So a second floor apartment there it is. There's a newspaper clipping, but that is the house in Brooklyn on Snedeker Avenue where Gershwin is born. By the way, now, instead of that building, there's a bagel cafe. There's a big modern building, and on the lower floor is a bagel cafe and a nail salon. So just if you driving through Brooklyn and you see a nail cafe and a nail salon, a bagel cafe and a nail salon, you know that's where Gershwin was born. I would assume on that building there must be some plaque or something. That's what I would think. This is Gershwin when he is 12 or 13, bar mitzvah age. So he's born in 1898. And his certificate identifies him as Jacob Gershwin, okay? No middle name, which is the normal procedure in Ashkenazic Jewry to give your kid a middle name. He did not have one, but he was loved, I have a feeling. He soon becomes known as George. And by the way, he changes his name to Gershwin around the time he becomes a professional musician. Let's keep our things muted because then you can hear what I have to say, okay? Okay, so after Gershwin, George is the second child. Then comes another boy, Arthur, who also, by the way, is a composer. We don't know his music, but he, you know, tried to, but you know, who's going to compose under the, with an older brother named of George is beyond me. But anyways, Arthur, he writes songs and stuff like that, some theater music. And a girl, Frances, who was the real musical talent in the family, the real musical talent. She's the first in the family to make a living through her music talents. But she marries young and devotes herself to being a mother and housewife and that kind of thing. By the way, when George was a child, the usual stuff, running around with friends, rollerblading and misbehaving in the streets. He gets in trouble a couple of times, not necessarily with the police, but with his parents. Until 1908, he doesn't really care much about music. Then he goes to a violin recital from a friend of his, and all of a sudden it's like, wait a minute, something's got to do. So he's 10 years old at the time, okay? So when he is about 11, maybe 12 or so, he tries to find piano teachers. He tries a few of them and finds someone by the name of Charles Hambitzer, who remains his piano teacher for the rest of his life, which is not a long life, obviously. He dies in 1938, which is one of the tragedies of American music. And this guy introduces him to music classical tradition, because this guy, Gershwin, can play piano, and encourages him to play, to attend concerts, you know, orchestral concerts. By the way, let's just talk about the Judaism, which is an important part. They are not religious or necessarily political, but more of a cultural and casual Jewish. I assume this comes out of a boom heritage of his. Can we silence our, mute ourselves, because I can't hear myself. Try to mute ourselves, okay? Beautiful. Okay, so in a 1938 interview, his mother, after he passes away, states that though she had put Orthodox Judaism behind her, other than a devout belief in the Ten Commandments, the family adheres rigidly to the Jewish faith, and the home was strictly Orthodox, kosher food, the whole thing. The children also were taught by rabbis, and all were bar mitzvahed. Now, later on in life, George's aunt remembers Passover Seders hosted by his father. And does anyone know, and you can raise your hands maybe, the actress Kitty Carlisle? Does everybody remember that name? Yeah, I have a vague, I think she was on some game show that I saw when I was, you know, younger or something. But she was a very good friend of Gershwin, and she speaks of attending Gershwin family Seders, where co-hosts George, and then a very famous pianist at that time, Oscar Levant. Do you know, anyone know that name? Mm-hmm. Oh, wow, I see some people do. Anyway, so they used to, George and Oscar used to preside over the service. And the way Kitty describes it, it's kind of a mad jazzy rhythm, which she characterized as a big joke. I'm not sure what that means, but there's that. Okay, moving on. Why is this not moving? Let's try this. Oh, there we are. I want to talk about the Tin Pan Alley influence on George Gershwin. And it's not really an influence, that's where he worked. In 1913, so George is 15 years old, he leaves school and he begins his career as what is called a song plugger in New York's Tin Pan Alley. So he earns about $15 a week. To earn extra, he also works as a rehearsal pianist for some Broadway singers when they wanted to audition. In 1916, he composes his first published song, which is called When You Want Them, You Can't Get Them. And it earned him a grand total of 50 cents. Not long afterwards, he writes his first big hit, which is Swanee, composed in 10 minutes on a bus. So the singer Al Jolson gets a hold of it and records it. And Swanee sold over 1 million sheet music copies and estimated 2 million record. It becomes the biggest selling song, this is later on in Gershwin's career, but the biggest selling song of his career. So it's the second song he ever writes. Now, what is, I mentioned a song plugger. A song plugger is a pianist that, it's part of the culture of the Tin Pan Alley thing, where he helps composers write their music. If a composer has a melody, they go to this pianist and he kind of plays it out, and he can help them write it out and that kind of stuff. So let's now, just before we do anything else, here's the relatively unknown singer, Al Jolson, singing Swanee.
Swanee, how I love you, how I love you, my dear old Swanee. I'd give the world to be among the folk in a G-I-X, I even know my mammy. Waiting for me, praying for me, down by the Swanee. The folks up north will see me no more when I go to that Swanee shore. Swanee, Swanee, I am coming back to Swanee. Mammy, Mammy, I love the old folks at home.
And one of the worst things about these so-called chats, I have to cut things off in the middle, otherwise we will be here till 12 o'clock tonight, which I'm more than happy to, but there may be some complaints. Anyway, by the way, he's a wonderful, wonderful pianist, Gershwin, really incredible. This is an example of him playing. He does this unbelievable amount of piano rolls. So that means that, you know, the piano, the thing goes on without the pianist, but he records these things. And many piano rolls, including his music and then others too. This is a song by the name of Whispering by John Schoenberger, no relation to Arnold Schoenberg, no relation at all. By the way, he records a couple of Yiddish songs too. One, a Pintel of Yid, he records on his piano. So it's on these piano rolls. I don't have a recording of that. I probably could find it, but let's just listen to a little of this Whispering by John Schoenberger, just to give you a sense of what the fabulous technique that this George Gershwin had. I want to talk about the term Tin Pan Alley, because most people attribute a certain kind of music associated with it, but that's not really what Tin Pan Alley is. Tin Pan Alley refers to the physical location of the New York City-centered music publishers and songwriters who really dominated the popular music of the United States in the late 19th century and early 20th century. So we're talking about, specifically with New York, 1885 to 1920. Now, specifically, physically, Tin Pan Alley was West 28th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue in New York City. So that whole block was with buildings with hundreds of composers and singers, and trying to craft their songs and with the specific idea of, obviously not recording yet because there wasn't the age of recording, but putting it into sheet music. I'll give you just one thing. I have the picture of Stephen Foster here. Now, he's way before that. He's in like 1850 or stuff. Now, he probably generated millions of dollars in, even not at his time, but totally, in sheet music sales. He sees little of it and dies in poverty. Why? There was no copyright protection laws in the 1800s. So songwriters, lyricists, composers, publishers, finally, in the Tin Pan Alley, specifically in New York, started working together for mutual financial benefit. Here's another a very interesting point. Following the Civil War, 1865 is when it's over, more than 25,000 new pianos were sold every year. And by 1887, something 25 years after that, over 500,000 kids were studying piano. So what is the need for that? 1887, we said that was the start of Tin Pan Alley. The demand for sheet music was huge, huge. Now, why is it called Tin Pan Alley? I mean, this is part of the Gershwin, what he comes out of. Tin Pan Alley is attributed to a newspaper guy, a writer, but named Monroe Rosenfeld, Jewish. And so while he was staying in New York, he was in that area, and he coins the term Tin Pan Alley to articulate the cacophony of dozens, you know, hundreds of pianos being pounded at once in publishers' demo rooms. And he said it sounded like hundreds of people pounding on tin pans, hence Tin Pan Alley. Okay? So by the way, in that area, that was, in that time, vaudeville plays a very important part in the story of this publishing in the Tin Pan Alley. These shows were really a very effective showcase, the vaudeville, for the new music. So you put it on a vaudeville thing, and then people like it. Oh, let's print it. And obviously the publishing houses profited tremendously from these kind of songs. Now, here's an absolute a denizen of Tin Pan Alley. This is Irving Berlin. That's where he publishes all his stuff. That's his milieu. Absolutely Disney. We're not going to play his music now. We can certainly do a wonderful chat on him also, but maybe that's at a later date. So, by the way, after 1920, Tin Pan Alley starts to go down. Why? Because then the need for sheet music becomes less for a host of reasons, but mostly because the phonograph and the radio supplanted the sheet music thing as the driving force specifically of American popular music. Now, Tin Pan Alley does not produce the orchestral scores to Siegfried. It's a popular music place, okay? So, Tin Pan Alley, that specific street, the companies still maintain themselves till the 1950s when, obviously it dissipated. One other thing about Tin Pan Alley, the music publishers at that time followed racial codes of the day. They either had their own typically white contract writers composing songs, or they opened their doors to publish songs of others, but hid the fact that songs were created by non-white or non-Christian artists. This is New York at that time. Now, Jewish songwriters often adopted anglicized names in order for their songs to be published. And this was necessary at the time where anti-Semitism was widespread in this country, and certainly this is probably a little pre-Gershwin, but even he has to change his last name to Gershwin instead of Gershwin or the other names that his grandfather had. Let's the early works for the stage. So since the early 1920s, now Gershwin is 22. He works with the lyricist Buddy De Silva, and together, they create the experimental one jazz opera. It's a one-act jazz opera called Blue Monday. There is a recording of it, and I'm trying to keep this short to make it work. But this opera is set in Harlem. And obviously this could, no question, it's widely regarded as a forerunner to the groundbreaking Porgy and Bess. By the way, in 1920, he's part of, this is right when his show business career starts. He's part of this a thing called Scandal. By the way, that's George and Ira. And he writes it with lyrics by Arthur Jackson, and it's I want to. There's a beautiful song, by the way, in this, and let me play. This is called "Somebody Loves Me." I wonder who. I mean, I wonder why. Here we go.
Somebody loves me. I wonder who. I wonder who she can be. Somebody needs me. I wish that I knew. Who she can be worries me. Every girl that passes by, I shout, hey, maybe you were meant to be my loving baby.
You were meant to be a baby.
Somebody loves me. I wonder who. Maybe it's you.
Won't you believe me?
Wonder who.
By the way, in 1924, let me just go a little, other, some of the other plays that you people might recognize. 1924, he and his brother, who was an incredible a partner to him. By the way, they live for their whole lives mostly together. The whole Gershwin, when the Gershwins move, when George moves, he takes his parents with him. He takes his brother, his sister gets married, but generally speaking, they live in the same, if not the same apartment, in the same building. It's unbelievable. So in 1924, he writes Lady Be Good, which includes such future standards as Fascinating Rhythm, ba-da-da-da-da-ba-ba-da-ba-da-ba, right? And Oh Lady Be Good. They follow up this this play with OK, O-O-H-K, as the name of the woman. By the way, K. Smith is his the so-called love of his life, and we'll talk about her a little later. Also a play in 1927, Funny Face, Strike Up the Band in 1927, Girl Crazy in 1930, which, by the way, Girl Crazy introduces the song I Got Rhythm that you heard originally when we were with that Japanese pianist, right? My favorite, and it's just because it was, I was in 11th grade in high school in Patchogue, Long Island, and I was so shy, I wouldn't even speak to myself, probably, but these wonderful people, these classmates I had, and they are still friends of mine, which is unbelievable that they, well, yeah, anyway. So there was a play called Of the Icing, and they said, you know, you have a nice voice, why don't you come. And they kind of pushed me on there, and it was a wonderful experience for me. And it, by the way, this is a fabulous play, and it's incredibly, incredibly appropriate at this time, talk about the political atmosphere in Washington, D.C. by the way, it was the first musical comedy to win a Pulitzer Prize for drama, okay? Late at night, there's a story. On January 3rd, 1924, so George is 26 years old, something, what was he? 25. So his brother, he and our lyricist Buddy De Silva, I mentioned his name before, were having a poker game in the Ambassador Billiard Parlor on 52nd Street on Broadway, if you know where that is, when an item in the amusement section of the New York Tribune, because there were 1,000 New York papers then, caught Ira's attention. And it was about a concert of new American music to be given by Paul Whiteman and his Palais Royal Band at Aeolian Hall on the 12th of February, which is a month from then, Abraham Lincoln's birthday. So falsely, the thing writes, George Gershwin is at work on a jazz concerto, ran the article. Irving Berlin is writing a syncopated tone poem. Now, this is not true, but they, I don't know what they did, but Ira got it in the thing. It was totally a shock to George, but he, you know, George said, oh, another thing for another piece, let's write something. So at that point, there was a musical comedy called Sweet Little Devil, which was gonna open in 3 weeks. This is 1924, and now, he says, oh, let's see what I can do to write a concerto. Now, by the way, Paul Whiteman was the most popular band leader of the 1920s and enjoyed the title King of Jazz. Although this was no jazz band, by the way, the Whiteman Band, it was a large dance orchestra that used jazz musicians from time to time. He contacts Whiteman, saying, "What's this all about?" He says, Whiteman said, "Don't even write the full score. Just give me a two-part piano thing. Short, doesn't have to be long, and we'll do it." By the way, I have a orchestrator, a really good one, by the name Ferdy Grofe. And those of you who know that name, that is the original orchestra and the only, I think, orchestration of the Rhapsody in Blue. So Whiteman, Ferdy Grofe orchestrates this thing. But here it is. When Gershwin's on the train to Boston for rehearsals of that musical, okay, Sweet Little Devil, he begins writing the thing on the 7th of January. That's 4 days after he gets that newspaper thing. Over the next few days, which he makes last minute changes to the play, the next 3 weeks, he finishes Rhapsody in Blue on the 24th of January. Okay, and 2 weeks later is the performance. We'll play just a little of it, just for those who don't know Rhapsody in Blue, which I would be a little surprised, but by the way, the original performance was with Gershwin playing piano. Are you ready for this one? Much of the piano part was improvised. So, but it was a real good success for him, but here we go. By the way, this is Oscar Levant playing, and the conductor is, I believe, a Whiteman. This is from a movie called Rhapsody in Blue in 1945. This is 7 years after George Gershwin passes away. So, it was kind of a peon to what he did. Moving on, one year later, he's based on his success with Rhapsody in Blue. He finishes a piano concerto. He really writes very fast, I have to say. So he uses his jazz-influenced classical style to write this piano concerto in F. It was premiered with Gershwin at the piano with the New York Symphony Orchestra conducted by Walter Damrosch. And I'm giving you names. I know the name. Some of you might not, but he was one of the real big New York conductors of that time. By the way, several letters exist in which George says the following. I pray to God that he will send me good blues for my concerto. So, there was a kind of a prayer kind of thing with Gershwin. Very, very quickly, we're going to not play the whole thing, obviously, but this is some of the... So what I'm hoping for, you know, these little short snippets of music that will encourage you to actually really listen to the music, to the whole pieces yourself. If you, any of you need any help from me with regard to where to go to get them, obviously, you know, let me know because I will help you. By the way, Gershwin always wants to study, music. So he's fascinated, and this might be a surprise to some of you, by modern music. And what I mean by modern music, I mean Schoenberg, Baird, Stravinsky, Mio, Shostakovich, all these guys, Ravel, and he travels to Paris to study with Nadia Boulanger. This is one of the great teachers of this woman composition in the 20th century. I'm going to mention names of, Aaron Copland, Elliot Carter, and there's so many composers that have studied with her. And she kind of takes Stravinsky as a model, and we won't go into that, but she's one of the great teachers. He applies to study with her. He's already in Paris. She says, I don't think so. Why? She writes, I was afraid that rigorous classical study would ruin his jazz-influenced style. So, I mean, this is unbelievable. Also, Maurice Ravel declines him as a composer because he said, I don't want to make you into Ravel, I want you to be you because you have such a unique talent. Igor Stravinsky, he asks, he said, well, you know, I'd love to study with you. So Igor Stravinsky, who's a real businessman, he says, well, how much do you make a year? So he tells him what it is. And Igor Stravinsky, who had a sense of humor, said, you know, I think I should be studying with you. So it's interesting. By the way, this is a photograph of George Gershwin painting. He's a really, really good painter. If you look at that piece of artwork, that's really, really technically beautiful painting. Now, who is the composer that he's painting? Anyone know? I will tell you. It is Arnold Schoenberg, the father of 12-tone music. They were like father and son. Okay, so Schoenberg, when Gershwin finally, in the last years of his life, goes to Hollywood, Schoenberg is there, and they become tennis partners. They play tennis all the time. That's what they do all the time. When Schoenberg goes out for some of his concert, his caddy, the guy who drives him, is Gershwin. They're inseparable. That's right. I mean, there's a lot of stories that I could say about that. Matter of fact, there's a composer by the name of Kurt Weill who wrote this wonderful kiddush that we do at our synagogue occasionally. I'd love to do more. He was a composer of dissonant music before he wrote that jazz style of his, and Schoenberg actually liked it. But then when he switched over to the popular stuff, Schoenberg said, "Oh, Kurt Weill's the worst composer in the world." But he does not do that with Gershwin. He calls Gershwin after Gershwin dies. He's emotionally affected by it, and he calls him a great composer. So it's amazing the whole story. But that's Gershwin with Schoenberg. There is a picture of Schoenberg with his family and playing tennis. There are pictures of Schoenberg. I even think there's a video of Schoenberg playing tennis with Gershwin. By the way, Gershwin's favorite composer among all these people, and he writes about him, is the composer Alban Berg, the composer of that fabulous violin concerto that we did a few years ago, and that the Kleinmans, one of their favorite pieces of music is the ever, is the Berg violin concerto. So anyway, this is his favorite composer. As a matter of fact, Berg, he knows all these guys. So Berg gives him a photo of him, a photo, an autograph photo, and he hangs it in his apartment. Getting to Porgy and Bess. This is Gershwin's most ambitious composition. He calls a folk opera, and the story is by Dubois Hayward, the man who wrote the story, and the libretto is by his brother Ira. The action takes place in a fictional neighborhood of Catfish Row, South Carolina. This is very sophisticated music. And some out of this opera comes some huge, what is called hit arias, Summertime. I Got Plenty of Nothing. It ain't necessarily so. When it was first performed in 1935, it was a box office flop. And as far as I'm concerned, and you know, most people, this is the most important opera, American opera of the 20th century. Now, he has a deep interest in both the Catfish Row, which he spends a summer at, and the Jewish shtetl. He ties them two together. The Gershwin family has several residences earlier in his life in Harlem. And so that brought George into contact with the Black population there. And he travels through the Gullah region of South Carolina to conduct research for Porgy. So there's a kind of a connection during which he really develops a very strong feeling from African American music and culture. Now there's a kind of a fascinating, controversial maybe, Jewish angle in the song It Ain't Necessarily So from Porgy, in which Gershwin parodies religious fundamentalism through the dope peddling, you know, Sporting Life, who in Sporting Life is one of the characters, and he kind of scolds and mocks other the residents of Catfish Row for believing various biblical stories. It ain't necessarily so. By the way, which was performed beautifully by Cantor Cone with an orchestration of mimes, I think in November, at that wonderful concert at the Emanuel Synagogue. So Gershwin's melody for the song's famous refrain is the traditional tune for the first bracha by, you know, you have an aliyah, Baruch Hu et Hashem Hamvorach, it ain't necessarily so. Yeah, you know, anyway, that could be said, who knows. In this regard, there's a commentator that says about Gershwin, while you can keep Gershwin out of shul, you can't keep the shul out of Gershwin. But anyway, and here's another story. It Ain't Necessarily So, it's a very powerful piece, coming as it did in 1943, that's 5 years after Gershwin dies, at the height of World War II and the Holocaust and the Shoah. Porgy and Bess makes its European debut in Copenhagen at the Royal Danish Opera. Now, this is during World War II. The Nazis are obviously enraged by this so-called degenerate work, which they said was dominated by subhumans, meaning that it was written about Jews, about Blacks, by Jews, about Blacks, sought but initially failed to shut down the production. Later in 1944, when the Nazis threatened to use the Air Force to bomb the Royal Opera to rubble, the producers of this opera decided that discretion is the better part of valor and ended the performances. However, the Danish radio responded by playing It Ain't Necessarily So alongside Nazi propaganda broadcasts. When it debuts in 1935, Gershwin turned down an offer from the Metropolitan Opera, to put it there. They go instead to the Theater Guild, which is a Broadway, at the Alvin Theater. That's where it premiered, at the Alvin Theater. Let's just listen to a little. This is Bess. I feel horrible. I can't play the whole thing because it's too long.
Nazi propaganda by showing it ain't necessarily so.
Yeah.
That is my favorite duet of the 20th century. Let's see if we can move this down a little, and then a little bit of this next one. So I had to play the whole summertime because it's summertime, so you know it's appropriate. We have 15 more minutes if you can hang on. It's such a beautiful subject, and I could talk about it for hours. Gershwin's early intimacy with Yiddish musical theater, of which he really, when he's a boy, 10 through 14, he's an extra in a lot of those shows on Second Avenue Theater, those Yiddish shows, okay? It really proves his intimacy proves really important when he's invited to collaborate on a Yiddish operetta with Sholem Secunda by Mir Bis Dushen. We didn't talk about him. We talked about Elstein last week, but we're going to talk about Sholem Secunda at another time. Wonderful composer, gifted musician, totally infused with Jewish tradition, but they were going to both write an opera together, operetta, Yiddish. So in 1929, you ready for this one? Gershwin signs a contract with the Metropolitan Opera Company to write an opera based on Anski's The Dybbuk. Okay, this is not stuff that people know, or most people, I should say. Then he begins to create some music for the work. He even plans to travel to Europe to study Jewish music traditions and to lend more authenticity to it. Let's mute. Okay. By the way, this musical does not ever transpire, doesn't materialize because it turned out that the rights to the play had already been assigned to an Italian composer, Lodovico Rocca. Okay. So this is, I don't want to say a tragedy, it's a tremendously unfortunate situation because we could have had Gershwin write a Jewish opera. The ability to really assess his handling of Jewish material was lost because with a Dybbuk project did not happen. But we do have an insight into the nature of the music. He had an early biographer by the name of Isaac Goldberg, and he says the following about that music that Gershwin wrote because he played it for him. He says, the music just turned the room into a synagogue with the distinct prayer of those to whom prayer has become a routine such as any other before coming to life as a Hasidic dance. It was stunning, the music. I don't know if there are sketches still there, but this is what his biographer said. It just transformed the room into a synagogue. Unbelievable. So, by the way, you know, Gershwin had a kind of a blue note technique, which is the black notes on the piano, you know, the kind of the notes that are not part of the scale. And, you know, if you even think of the Rhapsody in Blue, where he goes, it's a real kind of a klezmer feel to the thing. If you just in your mind's ear, think of the opening of the Rhapsody in Blue, it's a very klezmer kind of feel to the thing. By the way, there's a tune that he writes that's called Swonderful. By the way, Ellery Mirabel sang that with the choir many years ago. It was beautiful, beautiful. I remember it like it was yesterday. Gorgeous, gorgeous production. But and the Swonderful is lifted right out of a song by the name of Noach's Teviah, which is Noah's Ark, which is a number in Avraham Goldfaden's operetta, Akedas Yitzchak. Okay, now Goldfaden was the father of Yiddish theater, not American Yiddish theater, but Yiddish theater, because he never came to the United States. But he, you know, we mentioned him earlier I think when we talked about the cradle songs. There's such a connection, such a connection. By the way, let me just say one more thing about the Jewish aspect of Gershwin. This is what he tells, what he writes to Lazar Siminsky, who is a Jewish, very well-known Jewish musicologist, composer, and pianist. This is Schoenberg saying the following. While I actually do not know much about Jewish folk song, I think that many of my themes are Jewish in feeling. Okay, here's another thing he says. In a 1925 interview with American Hebrew, it's a publication, first one says the following. The traditional Hebrew religious melodies have had a marked influence on modern music, and that the Hebrew chants possess a particularly plaintive wail, which gives them a universal appeal to myself. Okay, so
that's... I've always cherished the desire to try the other end of the job and to do the interviewing myself. So this afternoon I cornered George.
Okay, I know what this is now. This is an interview, it's gonna last a couple of minutes, with Gershwin, and he talks about how he writes songs. And I want you to listen very carefully. You know what he says? I'll say it before he says it. How do you write a song? He says, I just write a melody without even the words, and Ira puts the words to it. It's a fascinating interview, and he ends up with playing a little of his own music. Just listen 2 minutes at the most. That's not it. Here we go.
I've always cherished the desire to try the other end of the job and to do the interviewing myself. So this afternoon I cornered George, asked questions very much at random, and took notes. I tried to think of questions you might ask yourselves if you had the opportunity. For instance, George, here's the query all composers encounter 3 times a day. When you work with your brother Ira, which comes first, the words or the music? Usually the music. I hit on a new tune, play it for Ira, and he hums it all over the place for a while until he gets an idea for the lyrics, and then we work the thing out together. Are you working on anything new right now, George? Yes, Ira and I are working on a new show called Pardon My English. The thing is already in rehearsal, and we're still trying to finish the score. What contemporary American composers do you most admire? Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin. Both of them have been very helpful to me. Incidentally, I believe Kern's Showboat score to be the finest light opera achievement in the history of American music. And I agree with you. Tell me, how did you get your start in music, George? Well, I left high school to take a job as a song logger at Remick for $15 a week. That's 45 less than I used to get. Remember, I said I was going to ask questions any member of the audience might think of. How much money do you make with George? About half as much as you do, Rudy. How much is that? 1/3 as much as I told you this afternoon, you liar. Now, look, George, let's remember we're artists after all. One more question. Which of your show tunes do you prefer yourself? This one, Rudy.
Mm-hmm. And we have to move on. This is they go to Hollywood because the situation with the opera Porgy and Bess did not really work out economically. So they moved to Hollywood in 1936 because of a commission by RKO Pictures to write the music for the film Shall We Dance, starring Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, which what he does is marry ballet with jazz in a really new way. The thing runs over an hour in length, like it seems like this lecture is going to. It took Gershwin several months to orchestrate and compose. Let's just talk just very quickly about the Hollywood time. They move, again, they live always together or within the next house. So they move to adjacent houses on North Roxbury Drive in Beverly Hills, where they pen some of the most incredible music. Matter of fact, Ira lives there until his death in 1983. The plan was to make quick money in Hollywood, then turn to New York for any number of other large, less commercial projects. And so that last year, in the backyard of Gershwin's house, you might find Lillian Hellman, Oscar Levant, Harold Arlen, Yip Harbor, who wrote the lyrics to The Wizard of Oz, Moss Hart, Harpo Marx, and a whole array of actors and actresses. Schoenberg playing tennis all the time with him, that is Arnold. Fanny Bryce, any of you have heard that name, actress and singer, she would plant flowers in his house. She was his gardener. And so there would be poker games and other social festivities. Gershwin writes, all the writing men and tunesmiths get together in a way that's practically impossible in the East. I've seen a great deal of Irving Berlin and Jerome Kern at poker parties and dinners, and the feeling around here is really great. So, by the way, this is the love of his life, says the following. You were always at ease with George. She says, he has a naturalness about him. If he were here right now, he'd probably walk over to the piano and play. By the way, her granddaughter, Kay Swift's granddaughter, says the following. They weren't married. Her grandmother and Gershwin were not married because George's mother, Rose, was unhappy that Kay Smith wasn't Jewish. So, by the way, the OK musical was named after her. I mean, there's much more to say. I'm going to close it up at this point. But in early in 1937, he begins to complain of blinding headaches and a reoccurring impression that he smells burnt rubber. He gives his last public performance, the Concerto in F with the Los Angeles Philharmonic, February 11th, 1937. That's 5 months before he dies, I believe. The concert was a success, but at one point, a very un-Gershwinian thing happens. He stumbles over a bunch of chords in a difficult passage. This is not normal him. By June, he was experiencing coordination difficulty and it's extreme, he was irritable, which is not normal for George Gershwin, who was very easygoing. Gershwin collapses at the home of Yip Harburg, who is, as I mentioned, a childhood friend of Ira. And
I just put my nails straight across. I'm going to file them.
Hello?
See, cut it back that short.
Excuse me, please do not talk. Okay, so I'm almost done. This is very touching. Kay Smith, his romantic poem.
I'm going to file it. Oh, okay.
One for a second.
It's better.
Can you please mute? Can you please mute? Thank you. Kay Smith, which was, you know, his girlfriend, was not the last to see him, but she was the first to know that he passed away. This is an amazing story. She writes, I was at a movie in Radio City with my daughter April, and suddenly I stand up and said, we're leaving. We got up the aisle, and April asked me, what's wrong? And I said, George is dead. When I got home, the phone call came. And she says, I think when something happens to someone you love, you know it, don't you? Mm-hmm. After his death from a brain tumor, two services, one at Temple Emmanuel in New York City, mm-hmm. and one Temple B'nai B'rith in the Wilshire Boulevard Temple in Los Angeles. And mm-hmm. that is the story that I have to say about Gershwin. Just very quickly, I'm gonna give you two small snippets here. This is
for me.
Right here, please.
Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers.
A corsage for the bride. Mm. It's all right.
Thank you, sir.
You'll be on your way, and I'll be on mine. Catch up.
You goddamn it.
Oh, this. My God.
I hope you enjoy your gaiety.
Thanks. I hope you enjoy your divorce.
Thanks. I didn't know getting married was...
Oh, that's all right. I'll get over it.
Oh, of course.
Our romance won't end on a sorrowful note. Oh, by tomorrow you're gone. The song is ended, but as the songwriter wrote, the melody lingers on. They may take you from me, I'll miss your fond caress, but though they take you from me, I'll still possess the way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. Smile, just me. The way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, they can't take that away from me. We may never, never meet again on the bumpy road of love, but I'll always, always keep the path. And still dream the way you changed my life. No, no, they can't take that away from me. No, they can't take that away from me.
And one last one to skip. We're skipping some, but I want to, this is the house that he lives in, the last house. There's Yip Yarberg, another picture of Gershwin, and one last two-minute thing of Thee I Sing, and this is from of Thee I Sing, the play. All right, one more time.
Stop wasting time. Put on your dancing.
Okay, and with all the other stuff, thank you everybody for joining. If you have any questions, ask, and there we go.
Thank you, Joseph. This was great.
Thank you. Well done.
Joseph, this was fabulous. And my two sisters joined us. My sister Linda from New Jersey and my sister Judy from Florida. Yay!
Oh, that's wonderful. That's
fabulous.
Joseph, it was great. Thank you.
Who was singing Porgy and Bess?
Who was singing Porgy and Bess in that snippet?
This was a recent
Broadway, the one at Lincoln Center.
No, it was not.
It was from the Met. They were from the Met, and yes, there was a show. It was on television. They were wonderful. Yes, they were marvelous.
I don't know who it was. The guy was, what's his name? The man. He's the same one. He plays that.
I don't remember what his name was, but anyway, it was great.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
This was
so many names.
Joseph.
Tonight.
Joseph.
Yes.
Larry Kurt, who was just in that last piece with Maureen McGovern, and Michael Wilson Thomas. Larry Kurt was the star of West Side Story.
That's right, with Carol Lawrence.
That's right. I saw it.
And me too.
Right.
And my sisters.
Joseph, a lot of names.
I haven't seen you in a while. And you mentioned Kitty Carlisle.
Right.
Us Hart.
What's my line?
Us Hart was her husband.
Danny and I were walking down I forgot where it was, on the, probably in the 50s of New York City, maybe a little bit on the east side. And Sandy, we see this woman coming toward us with a mink coat and everything. It was in the winter. And Sandy said, "That's Kitty Carlisle." And after she said it, I realized it was. And
she was a doyen of society, too. She was really something. And What's My Line with Clifton Fadiman. Joseph, you mentioned so many names.
It took me about 3 minutes to
unbelievable memories. Yeah,
baby, no, who would have enjoyed that, Joseph?
Yeah, Kitty Carlisle was married to
Moss Hart, I think.
It's a show that Moss Hart wrote called Act One, and it's free on television right now.
What is the name of it?
He died very young.
Act One. I saw it the other night. It was a Broadway play. It became a Broadway show.
Wow.
And I can't remember where I saw it, but if you want to see it, just look up Act One on TV, and you'll find it.
Wow.
It was terrific.
We'll definitely do that.
Anything that George Gershwin was not really great at? I mean, he really was a prodigy, wasn't he?
He wasn't too good at golf. A genius, not a prodigy. He was a genius.
Yeah.
No one could do that without being
amazing.
It's a gift. It's an incredible gift.
In his early first few years, he was basically a street kid. You know,
But he had it. And thank you so much for doing that research.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. It was wonderful.
It was great.
Thanks a lot. Very good.
Okay.
Hello to everybody.
Hello.
Hello.